I'm always looking forward to our time together just to spend time in the Word of God. Just before we begin with our opening prayer, I want to invite all of our visitors that are sharing with us. And once again, I would like to say that we have notes and outlines that are available. We will be delighted to share them with you. If you can go to our website and drop us a note, and we'll get them to you at no charge. And while you're there, we'd like to pray for you as well. So put your prayer requests there so we can pray with you. And finally, our prayer conference call immediately follows our Bible study, which is at 7:30. At 7:30 is our Bible study. The conference call number is 667-770-1295. That is a conference call for our prayer line, and we look forward to joining with us. Go to our website for information. Father God, we thank you tonight for another opportunity just to come and to study your word. Thank you for guiding us through this day. Thank you for bringing us to this place. Thank you for your word that you make available to us, so that we can study, we can learn, and we can be better believers and better Christians. We pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that tonight you will shed light on these scriptures, give us insight, that we can draw application, that we can share with someone else about the goodness of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. For those of us that are joining with us, as mentioned, we are coming through the Bible expository and Illuminator, Bible Expository and Illuminator. That is our Sunday school or church school book that we have, and it's available to our membership, and it's also available when you request it online. We are in the summer quarter of it, and just a quick review for 1 minute. We started our lesson in June 19th, where we talked about Asaph, and how that he almost slipped when he looked at the wealth of the wicked. Then we looked at Ezra, God's leaders, and how to be faithful in leadership. Last week we looked at Haggai and how he calls us for faithful service. And tonight we're going to look at Micah and how Micah stands firm for God. Now, I know a lot of these Old Testament Bible studies, I'll just be honest with you, some people say, yeah, you know, they're not interesting. And I'll just say some folks say they're just boring. And you know, I kind of understand some of that, but there are great truths and great illustrations and great lessons in these Old Testament illustrations and lessons. And we try to bring in current day applications for all of our Bible studies. And you'll find some of the richest truths are found in the Old Testament prophecies. Looking ahead on next week, we will look at Habakkuk next week. And then the final week in July, which is July 24th, and we will visit the 26th, we will look at Ezekiel. And that will close out our session on Faithful to Prophecy, because Unit 1 was Faithful to Service in June. July was Faithful to Prophecy, and that's where we are now. And we'll close out that session in two more weeks with Habakkuk and Ezekiel. So tonight, we want to look at Micah. Micah is yet another one of the minor prophets that has a major word and a major lesson for us. Micah, well, this whole Old Testament, particularly all of Ezra and Micah, God done so much for his people that his people forget what the Lord has done for them. We talked about Ezra, we talked about Haggai, how that whatever they get, it was never enough, and how Ezra, they were supposed to build the wall, but they decided to build their houses first, say God's house could wait. So these people, God done so much for them. And now tonight we continue with Micah. And Micah continues the message to the people of God. Now, Micah is an interesting prophet. Micah began his ministry with King Jotham. And this is important. He began his ministry with King Jotham. He was the king of the southern kingdom. He also prophesied during the reign of Ahaz. Now, under Jotham, nobody listened to Micah. Under Ahaz, nobody listened to Micah. Finally, some folk listened to him in Hezekiah, but Micah never, ever gave up standing firm for God. Now, this is one thing the Old Testament priests and prophets, they had such dedication to ministry. Look, Micah preached anywhere from 16 to 25 years before anybody listened to him. 16 to 25 years. And the message was, let's turn to God. And when I think about 16 to 25 years, nobody listened to the message. And all the Old Testament, all the Old Testament prophets pretty much had the same testimony. They would preach, nobody would listen. Doom was being prophesied, they didn't care. God had delivered them from Egypt, delivered them, carried them into Babylon, delivered them away from Babylon, back into building the wall. They shouted for a minute, didn't care anymore. And Micah, we find that they are going back to worshiping false gods. God was so faithful to them, as he is to us today. How many times does a message go out week after week, Sunday after Sunday, month after one month, and people still don't listen? They always feel that there's more time, or I have more time. But Micah stands firm. So Micah chapter 2 is where we pick up our lesson tonight. And Micah, and I'm going to read it in the NIV version, Micah chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. NIV says, woe to those who plan iniquity. Woe to those who plan iniquity, to those who plot evil on their beds. I'm still in verse 1. At morning's light, they carry it out because it is their power to do it. That's a powerful verse in Micah chapter 2, verse 1. Here's verse 2. They covered fields and seize them, and houses and take them. They defraud people of their homes. They rob them of their inheritance. Then verse 3. But this is what the Lord says to the people that's doing this damage in verses 1 and 2. So let me back up a second. Woe to those, that King James says, woe for those who devise, who plan. Woe to those who plan to sin. All sin is bad before God. But premeditated sin, and that's what verse 2 is, but premeditated sin is worse. Here Michael speaks plainly to those who devise iniquity, those who plan sin. In this case, those who oppress others through their greed and covetousness. So you see, they devise a plan of sin. They plan to do wrong, to oppress those persons through their greed and covetousness. So we can understand. Micah is telling them, woe to you guys that's planning to do evil, to do harm, to oppress those through your own greed and covetousness. That's what he said. But then he goes on to say, and he describes how they do it. At morning light, he says. Now, typically, thieves practice their work at night. I guess it's not true too much today. People doing all kinds of stuff in the daytime. You know, used to the time, all the wrongdoing was at night. People got robbed at night. Houses got broken into at night. Cars were broken into at night. But now it doesn't matter. People break in and steal any time at all. But back in ancient times, most of the time, the thieves practiced their work at night under the cover of darkness. So in ancient world, the law courts or the courts would open up their business in the morning light, because the rising sun to them demonstrated that light was displacing darkness. Now, Micah sees the corruption of Israel's courts. Now, see, this is really important. Micah sees the corruption of Israel's courts and how they practice their theft and evil at the morning light when the courts open. This is a right now, today verse. Their courts open for business in the morning because they wanted to have the corruption of Israel's law. They work the law for the greed of the people. They had planned to do it. And that's what Micah is saying. You plan to do sin. You get up early in the morning when the courts open up. And you practice these things against the less fortunate for your own greed and covetousness. And that's what verses 1 and 2 Michael is saying. It's a covetousness people. They are. And then they said, and the reason why they do it is because it is the power of their hand. In other words, they get there in the morning time, they cheat, they rob, they take away. And why do they do it? We would say, why did you do it? Because I can. Why did you do such a thing? Because I can. I just can do it. Why do our leaders do certain things? Because they can. See, because the Bible says, It is in the power of their hands. So because they have the power in their hands, they can commit what they want against people that don't have the law or the resources on their side. Now, many of us, we don't know what sin we would commit if we were in authority. We really don't. We like to think that we would be gentle, we'd be fair, but when we get to places where we are overwhelmed with power, overwhelmed with authority, overwhelmed with money, anything we want, we would do it because we can. That's what's going on right here, because they have the power in their hand. And Micah is telling them, stop it, because you're taking and not giving to God. So we come down to verses 3-5 of Micah chapter 2. Micah begins to talk to them and say, the proud people will be brought low. Now, he says, against this famine, this is Micah speaking, as the Lord has given it to him. Micah says, against this family. What family? The Israel family. The Israel, his people, against this family. I am going to devise a disaster. You have devised plan for yourself. In verse 2, we just read. But now it says, now wait a second. Since you devise a plan to take advantage of people and for covetousness, he says, I'm going to devise a disaster upon you because it's justice. He gave them what they gave others. It's a hidden secret there. They devise a plan to do evil, to take. God is now devising a plan to them what they did to others. That's what against this family I am devising. I'm planning a plan. Since you had a plan to destroy, I got one to destroy. So you can feel yourself what others have felt. Then he goes on to say, nor shall you walk haughtily, nor shall you walk in pride, for this is an evil time. Micah is saying, look, you were, but now you're not going to walk proud anymore. This is an evil time. Micah rebukes the pride among God's people and announces that this is an evil time to come. It's time for the judgment of God coming on God's people. And they're going to be brought low. They're going to be brought down. They're not going to be proud anymore. And then he goes on to say, to a turncoat, he has divided our fields. This is Micah talking to them. See, part of the judgment was that they were going to be conquered by the Assyrians and will leave their land in possession of strangers. So the King James says, to a turncoat, he has divided our fields. This is what Micah is saying. Which means that because of what you've done, I've devised a plan, and the plan is you're not going to be proud anymore, and your fields are going to be divided. You're not going to have all of it. The possession of it will now be part of your enemies, which is strangers, which are the Assyrians. Why? Because they did not want to follow God's plan. Now, when you look at 6-9, Micah reminds them that there are some false prophets out there that's prophesying in reverse of what I'm saying. And Micah is telling them, be careful and don't listen to them. And this is what the false prophets say, beginning at verse 6. Don't prophesy to us, their prophets, the false prophets say. Do not prophesy about these things. And these things are what Micah just said about the depression, the losing the territory. You're not going to be proud anymore. The false prophets are saying, nah, it ain't all true. And Micah is saying what the false prophets are saying. Do not prophesy against these things. Disgrace will not overtake us. What they're saying is, God is too good to us. Disgrace is not going to overtake us, no matter what you say, Micah. The false prophets are saying, hey, I hear what Micah is saying, but look, verse 7. Now the false prophets go back to verse 7. Your descendants of Jacob, should it be said, does the Lord become impatient? Does he not do such things? What they're saying is, wait a second. Didn't your God promise that this and that to take care of you? Now the false prophets are throwing it back up into Micah's face, up to the people. Wait. Micah is saying you're going to get destruction. The false prophets are saying, whoa, it ain't going to happen to us. We God's people and the descendants of Jacob we are. So we know that we're going to be taken care of. And he's telling them, do not my words do good to the one who lives upright? So Micah is trying to tell them that they are really in trouble. But the false prophets, and then it goes on to say, do not pretell, pretell, P-R-A-T-T-L-E. Do not pretell, do not pretell. When God's prophets come to God's people, they did not receive it. They disregarded God's word as mere pretell, P-R-A-T-T-L-E. And that means false prophets. As a result, since they did not believe the real prophets, he stopped sending them prophets like Micah. How long does God have to send preacher after preacher, evangelist after evangelist, word for you today, Bible study, preachers all over the place, word is really available to anybody, and yet people still will not follow or listen to God? Is the Spirit of the Lord restricted? You see, in their foolishness, the people of Israel thought God was the problem. They thought God was being unjust, and the false prophets were telling them the truth, that God can't get rid of you. He made a promise to your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the false prophets were kind of saying that and saying what you're doing now, the evil that you're doing now, doesn't trump the promise that God made for you. But they are lying to the people of God. And then it goes on to say, is the Spirit of the Lord restricted? See, their foolishness, they actually begin to believe that God was the problem. They needed to understand that there was no restriction on the Spirit of the Lord, but they provided the restriction. God's Spirit is available to them, but because they didn't want to receive it, they are now saying that we are restricted from receiving it. That's what, is the Spirit of the Lord restricted? No, it isn't. If you open up your heart and if you understand, God is talking to his people. So you got the word of God in one ear and you got false prophets in another ear. And one's telling you, oh, it doesn't matter, God's got it. And the other hand, God is saying, obey my word. And then you're going to listen to the voice that pleases you the most. And the false prophet gives you a better ear, then hey, you'll go that way, and then we will begin to blame God for our devastation by leaning toward the false interpretation of the word. Do not my words do good to him who walks uprightly? See, he's answering the question. You blaming me for what I'm going to do to you. Do not my words do good? If you were doing good, if you were obeying the word of God, yeah, when you walk uprightly, you wouldn't be faced with all the damage that I prophesied in verses 1 and 2. You see, the key to their preservation was in the midst of judgment. God's word, if they would stick to it, obey it, they would escape. No, when they rejected God's word, rejected the word of the prophet, rejected the word of Micah, when they rejected God's words, they were left poor and destitute, both materially and spiritually. So then he goes on to say, this is not your rest. Micah exposed the lies of false prophets. This is not where you're going to wind up. This is not your rest. You don't rest with these false prophets. Micah exposed the lies of false prophets, showing that they can never really give rest. You can't give rest, what a false prophet says. Micah says, they can't give you rest. He exposes their lies. He says their words of false prophets are defiled and bring utter destruction. Instead of peace, rest, and restoration of God's word, the false prophets cannot give you rest. If a man should walk in a false spirit and speak in a lie, and what he's really saying there, the judgment is looming on the horizon, especially for this particular kingdom of Israel. There were false prophets who spoke of days of wine and drink, giving false comfort to a deceived people. They were the real false prophets, not the true prophets of God, as they were falsely called by the ungodly in Micah's day. When I look into this text, what were these false prophets telling them? That God ain't got nothing for you. But what the false prophets were saying, when I dug deep into it, in Micah 2:6, the only prophet they wanted was the one to tell them that there was plenty of alcohol. When you read the text, read some of the other writings, they had become so involved in lavish living that all they wanted to do was to get a word from somebody to encourage them to stay on their sinful path. And if somebody had gave them that, say, don't worry about Micah. He's just an old prophet. But listen to me. I got this. And that's just like the voice of Satan. Many persons would do more and could do more, but we must remember we always have this voice telling us why we shouldn't, how we'd be better off by doing this. You don't have to do it now. Do it later. And little by little, we find ourselves drifting away from what God has planned for us. So in Micah chapter 2, through these 11 verses, he's trying to tell them, don't listen to the false prophets. I'm going to stand and continue to talk about God. Because this whole thing is Micah stands for God. No matter what the people did, no matter how they were enticed, Micah is not afraid to stand up and tell them what the word of God says. And while we're on this topic, you know, one thing that, I can't make a broad statement because, I think a lot of conditions of the people in our society I'm going to say because the word of God is either not delivered to them or they're rejecting it. And I kind of leave it there because I don't want to give the impression that only a few people are giving the word. There are lots of people giving the word. They really are. But it seems we have more people rejecting than receiving. So is it the word or is it an opinion? Is it somebody's theological explanation of the word? Or is it the real hard-cutting word? Because to be honest with you, just like in this text, the false prophets was giving them what they wanted to hear. And they would say, oh, God is too merciful. He's not going to do that. And God say, I got a plan. Just like you devise a plan to hurt people, I got a plan, I'm divine. And he sent devastation. And all I'm saying is, even though subconsciously we may not be thinking about it, but we got to make sure that we devise plans to witness, to show God's word. We got to devise a plan to walk, to obey. Yes, there are struggles. Yes, there are disappointments. But we've got to plan to do the right thing. We've got to plan to make sure we pray. Because the adversary in the other ear says, you got time. God is gracious. Don't worry about it. He's not good. He's too good of a God to do that. Besides, you've been getting away from what you're doing for a long time. Just go on and continue. God is full of grace. And that's what the false message comes in our ears. But the message in the lesson tonight is, God is also devising a plan of judgment for those that don't listen to his word and obey his word. And the final thought for tonight is, what voice are we listening to? Is it the voice that appeases us to make us feel good in our wrongness? When we get to a place where we're discouraged and we're downtrodden, do we find people that are in the word? Or do we go to people that's going to tell us what we want to hear that's not biblically based? And that's what's happening in Micah. They didn't want to hear what the word, they wanted somebody to give them an encouragement, continue to do what they're doing. And what God says, okay, you keep on listening to those folks. I got a plan and it's going to be judgment. So the question is, what voice are we listening to? And it's a thought-provoking question. What voice? What voice are we? Are we going to stand for God? Or will we listen to the voice that will weaken our spirit, weaken our fellowship, weaken our witness? Or are we going to stand for the message and the word of God? And that's the message of this lesson tonight. Who will we stand with and for? When it's so easy, it's really easy to just turn and follow the course that's laid out that does not bring God glory. It's a struggle sometimes to do right. It's easy to do wrong. Why? Because we have a wrong, sinful nature. But if we let God in, he will lead and he will guide us. Just a couple of questions. I did send this out to you in the email. These are practical points. Number one, to turn from God's ways is to sacrifice the blessing he has bestowed on us. To turn away from God is to disregard the blessings he has bestowed on us. It's Micah chapter 2, 4 through 5. We can turn away from the way of God by not accepting or to sacrifice the blessings that he bestowed on us. That's how we turn away from God. He's done so much and we're like, ah, no big deal. Number two, it is foolish and disastrous to take the advice of those who reject God's word. Micah 2:6. It's foolish and dangerous to take the advice of those who reject God's word. We said that before. If they can't give you a biblical reason why you should continue, we need to let those persons go. It's foolish and dangerous to take advice from those who reject God's word. Number three, we have nothing to fear from God if we walk according to his word. Micah 2:7. We have nothing to fear because the false prophets would have you think that God is not on your side. Number four, to rob others of their dignity is to rob them of the glory or the blessing God has for them. Micah 2:8 and 9. To rob others of their dignity is to rob them of their glory or blessing God has for them. We need to make sure that we preserve human dignity. Don't insult a person to bring them down. Number five, favorable outward circumstances cannot save us from internal corruption. I like that. Favorable outward circumstances cannot save us from internal corruption. That's Micah 2:10. And finally, sinners are always welcome. Sinners always welcome those who approve of their lifestyle. Sinners are always welcome when they know that they want to get right. That's Micah 2:11. That concludes our lesson tonight. It's 7:23. These six practical points for discussions from Micah chapter 2 are in your notes. Take those discussions, look at it, look over the lessons. Try to ask God to reveal to you where we are, where you are, in Jesus' name. Father God, in the name of Jesus, bless us now. Help us, God, to hold on to your word.
You just
help us to stand.
Watch the Lord.
Help us not to turn back. Help us to honor you.
You
help us not to discredit what you have done.
You
help us to be satisfied with what you've given us. Be with us in the name of Jesus. Be with us, O God. Guide us in the name of Jesus. We rebuke the hand of the enemy. We rebuke the voice that's easy to listen to. Help us to believe, God, that you have the best for us. And if we're fallen, continue to forgive us and restore us. In the name of Jesus, bless us now, God. In the name of Jesus, I'll see you Sunday morning, Facebook Live, 11 a.m. In Jesus' name. God bless you, my brothers and my sisters.